Well, good morning, everyone. Morning. Good to see you all here. And it is just great to be in the house this morning. So some of you may know me, some of you may not know me. So my wife and I have been at Kingdom City for close to 5 years. We've been married for 32 years. I know I don't look that old, but it's true. We've got 4 adult girls. 3 of them are married. So, you know, often people would ask, well, just how long until, did you really miss, not having any boys? I just would always say, well, you just got to wait and then the boys come. So we've got, 3 of those are married, and our youngest one will be married in October. And, you know, then as that family grows, you get grandkids. So we've got 5 grandkids, and we've got 1 more coming in October. So our house and our tribe is growing, and it's exciting. So Sandy asked me, it was a couple months ago to preach, and I didn't answer right away, and then I finally said, yes, I'm going to preach, and I was just like, I didn't have something just burning on my heart of what I wanted to share, and it was about 6 to 7 weeks ago, all of a sudden God highlighted, and he's like, okay, that's what you're going to share on. So I started to process through all of that, and there's a lot there, and I was like, well, what do I share on? And so today's word is kind of in 2 parts. So that's just how it's going to go. And just the other thing I wanted to say is this is much more of just kind of a heart-to-heart word this morning. So from my heart to yours, and I just, my prayer is just that God would really, touch you and just speak deep to you there. So in your own life, have you ever experienced a season or where you feel just like all hell is against you? Just things are just nasty, and it's just like, you know, you're struggling. There's hard things that you're going through. It doesn't matter what you do or what steps you take. It's just like nothing seems to be in your favor. Your life is just full of anxiety. Your nights are short, sometimes sleepless. You dread having to deal with or converse with the person or the party on the other end of the conflict. And your mind just reels, playing just different scenarios, trying to find solutions to the problem. All you want to do is just escape the prison that you're in. I'm sure everyone in this room has experienced something like this to some degree or another. It may have been a family issue, a friend issue, or job related. Possibly it was COVID related and the pandemic took its toll on you. I recently had something like this in my own life. And it was actually, when I say recently, it's actually been over the past couple years. And my wife, Marilee, she heard me say many times comments like, I just want this to be over. I need these people to be out of my life. This has taken years off of my life. While those were realities and desires in my heart, God had very different plans. This happened in Joseph's life, and his situations would top almost anything in any one of our lives. I want to give you a brief overview of his life. And for those of you who are not familiar with Joseph, he's an Old Testament Bible character whose life fills the last 13 chapters of the book of Genesis. Joseph is the second youngest of 12 brothers, and he's got 1 sister. His father, Jacob, he was 91 years old when Joseph was born. And the story picks up in Genesis when Joseph is 17 years old. 10 of Joseph's brothers are stepbrothers, 3 from different mothers, and his youngest brother is a blood brother. And there's only 7 years of age difference between Joseph and his oldest brother. That's a lot of kids in 7 years. His youngest brother is just a handful of years younger than him. If you think that your family's dysfunctional, I would say his family is a lot more dysfunctional than yours. So he's got 1 dad. He's got 2 wives. He's got 2 maidservants who his dad actually married. So now there's 4 women there. There's a whole lot of favoritism. There's jealousy between them all. 2 of his brothers are murderers, and 1 of his oldest brothers slept with 1 of his dad's maidservants. And while Jacob, his father, followed the living God, there was a ton of idolatry just mixed in throughout the family. So here's some insight into Joseph. He was that annoying brother who would run and tell on you whenever you would get into mischief. Well, some of you were this sibling. Some of you had this sibling. Joseph's dad, he had a favorite wife. He had a favorite son and was very willing to express this among the family. Joseph just happened to be the favorite among all of his brothers. And his father publicly proclaimed this by outfitting him with a special coat that signified he was the favorite. Not only did Joseph's father publicly proclaim this, but Joseph proudly rubbed this into his brothers' noses. And this caused incredible hostility among them to the place where his brothers hated him. To top it all off, he had a couple of dreams that he shares, which escalates the whole situation to another level. In both dreams that he has, he's portrayed as this high-level leader, and his whole family is all bowing down to him. His brothers, they hear this, and they're just furious with him. And they just want him out of their life. They've had enough of his arrogance. So the whole family is a farming family, and his brothers are way off. They're tending the sheep in a town a couple, like 80 to 100 kilometers away. And they see him coming, and they devise a plan. We want to get rid of Joseph. We're done with him. Let's kill him. Let's throw him in a pit. And then we'll just tell Dad that a wild animal got him, so he's gone. And his oldest brother still has a little bit of heart for Joseph. And he talks to the brothers, no, we can't kill him. Let's just put him into this old well, and then he just had a different plan. So his oldest brother wanted to actually send him back to his dad. So the rest of the brothers, they're having lunch, and they see this caravan of traders passing by, and they decide, okay, well, maybe killing him isn't the nicest thing to do. Let's just sell him. We can actually pocket some money out of this guy, and he's gone, out of our lives. So Joseph is now sold. He's taken, and he's this caravan of traders. They take him to Egypt, and there he's sold as a slave. And his brothers, they take his coat, this coat that his dad had made for him. They tear it all up, and they make it look like he was attacked and a wild animal actually killed him. And upon returning home, the brothers share this news with their father, and his father is absolutely devastated that his favorite son is now dead. And he mourns the loss of his son for days and for weeks. So just let the reality of this just sink in. Let's just say that you come home from work one day and you receive news that your teenage son or one of your kids has been killed or they've been kidnapped. And there's very little information or details around what had happened. How would you respond with that? So that's just in the immediate, but then weeks turns into months and it turns into years and you don't get any more information. What would you say? How would your conversations with God go? Some of us may say, God, why? Why would you let this happen? This would have been a dark, dark day with the unknown of the reality of what had happened. Some of you can relate with this. So at 17 years old, Joseph has no family. He's living as a slave in a foreign country, and he actually gets he's bought by captain of the guard of Egypt. And what's amazing in this story is that there's no mention that Joseph goes into a dark, deep pity for himself and his situation. I'm sure his heart is broken, his family is gone, and I'm sure that there was extreme wounds in his life deep down inside that would have needed to be healed. But through all of this, Joseph remains faithful. In Genesis 39, verses 2 to 6, here's what it says. The Lord was with Joseph. He became a successful man. and he was in the house of his Egyptian master. His master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord caused all that he did to succeed in his hands. So Joseph found favor in his sight and attended him, and he made him overseer of his house and put him in charge of all that he did. From the time that he made him overseer in his house and over all that he had, the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. And the blessing of the Lord was on all that he had in house and field. So he left all that he had in Joseph's charge. And because of him, he had no concern about anything but the food that he ate. Those of us that are business owners, wouldn't you love to have this guy as an employee? All you got to do is worry about the food that you eat, the meals that you consume. So in your dark situation, whatever that may be, how are you processing through that? Some of us, we may react and we may just curl up in a corner and just crying out to God, waiting for him to intervene. Some of us, we don't have that demeanor. We get angry. We are mad. We're mad at God. Why would you put me through this? Why do I have to go through such a horrific thing? Because of what happened, you're ready to throw in the towel. Maybe some of you are ready to run from God. In my own dark situation, my conversations with God were, why? I don't understand. I was only trying to help someone out, and this is how I'm rewarded? God, where are you in this? If we reflect back to the verses I just read, here's what it says about Joseph. The Lord was with Joseph, and he became a successful man. You have to remember, he's serving as a slave. He is not free, but the Lord was with him. And he became successful. His master saw that the Lord was with him. It was very evident how Joseph walked things out, that the living God was inside of him. The Lord caused all that he did to succeed. Whatever Joseph put his hands to, God was in it and it flourished. Joseph found favor in his master's sight. He made him overseer over his house and put him in charge of all that he had. The Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. The blessing of the Lord was on all that he had in house and field. So he left all that he had in Joseph's charge. And because of him, he had no concern about anything except the food that he ate. How you respond in your circumstance will determine how God works in your dark situation. Joseph honored God throughout, and as a result, God greatly blessed him as a slave. He had gone from being a bullied brother to overseeing the captain of the guard's estate. For myself, I finally came to the place in my own situation where I quit asking God about the things that I didn't understand and just those why questions. And I started asking God. I said, God, teach me what I need to learn through this situation. That was a turning point for me because my perspective was now focused on the future of what God wanted to accomplish through this turmoil and not in the muck of the situation. God also showed me in this that he's going to bring people into our lives, good people and bad people, that are going to test us, that are going to why does he do this? He does it to test us, but he does it also to grow our character and to prepare us for another season, for the next season. If I had become totally bitter and completely full of anger over this whole situation in my own life, I would have miserably failed. God also asked something of me during this time, which took me months to comply with. It was God's way of saying to me, do you trust me, Brent? Do you believe that I am sovereign, that I see the big picture? Do you believe, and are you willing to submit and to fully surrender to me, no matter what the cost? Are you willing to put what I have asked on the altar without fully understanding why. It took me 8 months to comply with God's ask. And once I complied, in my heart I was expecting that this conflict would be over and I would just be released. No, there was another 10 months of hard going that I had to wade through. And all of this, I kept saying, God's got a bigger plan. God knows what he is doing. God loves and cares for those people on the other side of the conflict just as much as he cares and loves me. Just as Joseph would have been confident that things were looking up for him, God put him through a bunch more tests also. As Joseph was enjoying his role over Potiphar's estate, Potiphar's wife took notice that Joseph was a very good-looking, well-fit, handsome young man and tried to entice him into having an affair with her. Now, this would have been very easy. It would have been an easy affair for Joseph to hide. He had no family around him, and there was no way that Potiphar's wife was going to say anything. And despite trying day after day to entice him, Joseph remains steadfast in his devotion to God and replies, this is what he says to Potiphar's wife, how can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? Potiphar's wife continues. She continues just to push in, and she's determined to win and to entice him. She wants this to happen. And it says that Joseph would not be with her. So he protected himself against this potential bad situation. One day, there's no one else in the house. And Potiphar's wife figures that, okay, this is the day. There's nobody else around. I'm going to make this happen. She enters the room that he's in. She grabs his garment and begs him to have sex with her. He immediately runs from the room and just sheds the jacket as she's got hold of it. Potiphar's wife is just frustrated with Joseph at this time. She screams that he's tried to rape her. The servants of the house come into the house and they see Joseph's jacket in her hand. And when Potiphar hears this made-up story, he believes it and he's furious with Joseph. And he has him thrown into prison. This is now about 8 to 9 years after Joseph had been sold as a slave and was initially brought to Egypt. So his life circumstances, they were definitely looking up and improving, but quickly took a huge turn for the worst. And it says that he was put in prison in the place where the king's prisoners were confined. And you may ask, why does a loving God who's supposed to care for me, why does he allow these horrible things to happen in our lives? So here's the answer. In James chapter 1, verses 2-4, it says this, count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, and let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. It says, and let steadfastness, because the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, and let steadfastness have its full effect. So what's steadfastness? It means being immovable, unchanging, loyal. God had to test Joseph to see if there was anything that could sway him emotionally, anything that could sway him physically and spiritually. These tests and trials are all part, they were all part of a bigger picture for Joseph. They're character building in the current reality for a future plan of how God will use us. How you respond in your negative situation and in your trials is critical. If you reflect back through the earlier part of the story, Joseph, he had a humility problem. He wasn't tactful in how he shared his dream, knowing full well that he was the favored one of his dad, and his brothers hated him. He was happy to rub it in his brothers' noses. And if I was honest, I'd have to admit that I had a bit of a pride problem myself in this situation and the conflict with the people on the other side.
I would have seen myself, I would have put my position myself a little bit higher than them. So God had to test me to see if I was willing to trust him. He tested me if I was willing to trust him and to see if I needed to win in this situation, even though I'd been wronged. To be really honest, everything within me did not want to comply with what God was asking. It was a massive ask of surrender for me and a huge win, in my opinion, for the other side. In my human understanding, it didn't make sense and it wasn't really right. But deep down, I knew. I knew that I needed to trust God and I needed to walk out what he was asking. I knew that he saw a much bigger picture that I didn't. There's going to be times in my life and in your life where the biggest ask of God is a massive sacrifice and a huge cost. Are you willing to say yes to that? They're all tests and trials for a bigger picture. So Joseph is now in prison and he spends the next 4 to 5 years in prison. And what does Genesis 39 say about that? Very similar to how he was in Potiphar's house. It's almost identical. So in verses 21, it says, "But the Lord was with Joseph and showed him steadfast love and gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. And the keeper of the prison put Joseph in charge of all of the prisoners who were there. Whatever was done there, Joseph, he was the one who did it. And the keeper of the prison paid no attention to anything that was in Joseph's charge because the Lord was with him. And whatever he did, the Lord made it succeed." So very similar to the in Potiphar's house. So now I want to fast forward to Joseph is now 30 years old and he's been in Egypt for 13 years. His brothers think he's dead and his dad thinks he's dead also, and he's just like, man, what happened? Like, really, what happened in that situation? So Pharaoh, he has two dreams that no one can interpret. Pharaoh's cupbearer remembers that Joseph had interpreted both his dream and the baker's dream years earlier when both these two guys had also been thrown into prison, and that Joseph's interpretation of this dream was very, very accurate. So Pharaoh calls for Joseph, and he's brought up from the pit of the prison, and then is cleaned up. And Pharaoh shares this dream with Joseph and wants Joseph to interpret the dream. So listen very carefully to the dialogue, as it's incredibly important. It articulates accurately what has happened in Joseph's heart over these past 13 years. It was part of the preparation process of what God wanted to do in Joseph's heart. So this is in Genesis 41, verses 15 and 16. "And Pharaoh said to Joseph, 'I have had a dream, and there is no one who can interpret it. I have heard said of you that when you hear a dream, you can interpret it.' Joseph answers Pharaoh, 'It is not in me, but God will give Pharaoh a favorable answer.'" So Joseph's pompous attitude was gone. He's no longer going after self-importance or trying to elevate himself above those around him or to promote himself. He's humble and he says that there is no way that he has the ability to interpret this dream, but only God. He then proceeds to give the interpretation of the dream in the latter part of chapter 41. And it says, "It is as I told Pharaoh. God has shown to Pharaoh what he is about to do. There's going to come 7 years of great plenty throughout all the land of Egypt, but after them will arise 7 years of famine, and all the plenty will be forgotten in the land of Egypt. The famine will consume the land, and the plenty will be unknown in the land by reason of the famine that will follow, for it will be very severe." And the doubling of Pharaoh's dream means that the thing is fixed by God, and God will shortly bring it about. Now, therefore, let Pharaoh select a discerning and wise man and set him over all the land of Egypt. So Joseph, he lays out this elaborate plan of how to store up in the years of plenty for those 7 years, and then to be able to use those plenty of 7 years to provide for the famine. And Pharaoh is so taken by what Joseph has presented. He says in verse 38, "Where can we find a man like this, in whom is the Spirit of God?" It was incredibly evident that Pharaoh saw the living God inside Joseph. Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, "Since God has shown this to you, there is none so discerning and wise as you. You shall be over my house, and all of my people shall order themselves as you command. Only as regards to the throne will I be greater than you." And Pharaoh said to Joseph, "See, I have set you over all of the land of Egypt." Then Pharaoh took his signet ring from his hand and put it on Joseph's hand and clothed him in garments of fine linen and put a gold chain around his neck. He made him ride in his second chariot, and they called out before him, "Bow the knee." Thus he set him over all the land of Egypt. Moreover, Pharaoh said to Joseph, "I am Pharaoh, and without your consent, no one shall lift a hand or foot in all the land of Egypt." Joseph goes from the pit of prison to basically being the most powerful man in the world, second to Pharaoh. There is no way that Joseph ever could have imagined anything like that. God had an amazing plan with what he was doing with Joseph, but it took 13 years to prepare him for that moment where he would meet, where he would become this most powerful man in the world next to Pharaoh. His life is completely changed in a matter of moments, but yet he remains humble. He remains a man with a very servant heart. This is an unbelievable promotion that Joseph received. And if it had not been for the 13 years of humbling and preparation that God had brought him through, it never would have happened. So in your situation, that you're, whatever it may be, how have you responded? God may have been asking you things in that. Were you angry and just completely just frustrated with God and just said, "Get away from me"? God has a much greater plan and a bigger plan. And if that was how you responded, God is such an amazing God of grace. You can go back and you can just repent for that sin, and God will take you right where you are now and will rework the story of your life, and he will take you right where you are and he will continue to work in your life. So the last little bit this morning, I want to focus on another part of the story. And this has to do with how Joseph had forgave his brothers for what they had done with him. During the 7 years of plenty, Joseph and his wife, they had two sons. The firstborn he named Manasseh, which means, "God has made me forget all my hardship and all my father's house." His second son he named Ephraim, which means, "God has made me fruitful in the land of my affliction." Somewhere between 21 to 22 years after Joseph's brothers had sold him as a slave, they came to Egypt seeking provision as the famine had spread across all of the earth. And because Joseph was responsible for selling any of the grain, his brothers came to him. And what happened? They bowed down before him, just as it had been in this dream that he had had years earlier. And they mocked him. "Are we going to come and bow down to you?" They had absolutely no idea that it was him, but he recognized them. And he treats them as strangers and questions where they're from and why they've come to Egypt. He speaks roughly to them, saying that they're spies. He strategically asks them questions about his younger brother and his father and tells them, you will not leave Egypt without your youngest brother being brought before me and being brought into my presence. The anxiety is building among the brothers, and they openly start discussing among themselves how they had abused Joseph, how they had sold him, and now God is repaying them for all of their evil deeds. Joseph completely understands what they're saying, but they've got no idea that he understands their conversations and that all of the conversation that they had had with Joseph, it had been through an interpreter. So they just think he's speaking Egyptian or Arabic. Simon, one of the older brothers, is then bound before them, and he's held in custody as a ransom until they would return with their youngest brother. Upon their return, Joseph's blood brother Benjamin is brought with them. And Joseph, strategically, he hosts a meal for them at his home. And he has them set around the table in order of their age. They're completely dumbfounded with this, but they're happy for the warm welcome. They're like, how does this guy know our age? There's only 7 years difference between us. How can he determine when we're born? And as they leave, there's one more test that Joseph puts on his brothers. He puts his silver cup into the grain sack of his blood brother, Benjamin. And after they'd gone a short distance on their way back to the land of Canaan, Joseph has his man go catch up with them, and they question him about stealing the silver cup. His brothers are so confident that they guarantee that they are upright, that they would never steal from anyone, and that they say, whosoever sack the cup is found in, that person shall die. Well, the cup had been put in Benjamin's sack, and that's where the cup is found. And now they're brought back into Joseph's presence, and there's incredible dialogue between Joseph and his brothers. And Judah, another one of his older brothers, pleads with Joseph, telling him that he had gave his own life as a pledge to his father for the safety of Benjamin. When Joseph can no longer contain himself, he orders that all of the Egyptians leave the room. He's alone with his brothers and then reveals himself to him. So in Genesis 45, verses 1-8, here's what it says. Joseph could no longer control himself before all those who stood around him. He cries out, make everyone go from me. So no one stayed with him when Joseph made himself known to his brothers. And he wept aloud so that the Egyptians heard it and the household of Pharaoh heard it. Joseph then says to his brothers, I am Joseph. It's me. Is my father still alive? His brothers, they couldn't answer him, for they were dismayed in his presence. Joseph says to his brothers, come near to me, please. And they came near, said to him. He says to them, I am your brother Joseph, who you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me. For God sent me here before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in the land these 2 years, and there are yet 5 years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. And God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on the earth and to keep alive for you many survivors. It was not you who sent me here, but God. He has made me a Pharaoh, or a father to Pharaoh, and the Lord over all his house and ruler over all the land of Egypt. You may be saying to yourself, well, that's all fine and everything for this guy from this Old Testament, for him to forgive, but you've got no idea what has been done to me, what's been done to my family. There is no way that I could ever forgive that person. There are endless offenses out there, Every one of us has been offended and wronged in one way or another. For some of you, it may be a cheating spouse. Others, it may be a crooked business partner. Some of you may have been raped. Possibly a former friend has now become a complete enemy. As long as you don't forgive, you will be held in bondage. And you will never, ever be able to live in freedom unless you forgive. The bitterness of your unforgiveness will consume you, and it will hurt you, and it will hurt those around you. You're going to have very little joy. You're always going to be on edge. You're going to be extremely short with those close to you. The lie that the devil tells us is that justice won't happen unless you do something about it. And if you take justice into your own hands, you are only going to create more mess. When you start and continue to walk in forgiveness, there will be undeniable peace in your life. Here's some key things that I want us to just take as a takeaway. They're just forgiveness principles that we can learn from this story. The first one, Joseph didn't let anyone know what his brothers had done to him. He says, he cries out in the room, "Everyone go from me." So all of the Egyptians had to leave the room. So it was Joseph and his 11 brothers. He was intent that not one Egyptian would know what his brothers had done to him 22 years earlier, because he had a plan of how he wanted to bring his brothers to Egypt. He wanted to bring his whole family to Egypt. And if the Egyptians had known what his brothers had done to him, they would have been incredibly reluctant to allow Joseph to walk out his plan, because Joseph was a hero in Egypt. It comes incredibly easy for us when someone has wronged us to speak negatively about that person. We say things that highlight the wrong that they did to elevate ourselves. We make ourselves out to be the better person and the offender look bad. If God was to display all of your sins on these screens here, how would that make you feel? Each of us would want to cower. We'd want to hide in the corner, run from this room. But as your sins are forgiven and God is silent about them, so you need to be silent about your accuser. It's an act of forgiveness. I've got to just say this to kind of close this little bit here. I want to say it's often important that you've got one person that you talk to work through your pain and hurts with. And this should just be a wise, trustworthy person that will not mention a word about your pain to anyone. And if your whole situation, if there's been a criminal offense there, you've just got to bring the law into that. You can forgive that person, but you've got to bring the law into the picture. The second takeaway here, your offender must not fear you. It says in verse 4, Joseph tells his brothers, he says, "Come close to me." He was weeping. He was full of tears as he revealed himself. Compassion poured from him. He had been speaking Egyptian, and his brothers would have had no idea that who he was. And it was important that they touch him and that they realize that it was actually him. 1 John 4:18 says this, "There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not been perfected in love." If your offender has fear of you, you are not walking in forgiveness. And you want your offender to feel the anxiety of your presence. Perfect fear casts out love. I think I said that wrong. Perfect love casts out fear. The third thing, don't cast guilt on your offender for what they've done. In verse 5, Joseph doesn't blame his brothers for the evil that they've done to him, but rather he points the whole situation to God, being God ordained to save the lives, to save their lives and countless others. And he says that it was not them who had sent him to Egypt, but God. A person who is full of bitterness could never, ever respond like that. Think of your own situation. Could you articulate to your offender that it was God who allowed the evil to happen for a greater purpose? That's a tough one for any of us. But God had done such an incredible transformating work in Joseph's heart so that he could actually say those words. The fourth thing is that God was in the middle of this whole situation right from the beginning. Because we are finite beings, we get caught up in the mess of the situation and we forget that God is all over it and that he's got a bigger picture, a bigger plan that we don't see and we don't understand. In my own situation, I was caught up in the turmoil and in the pain and I had to wade through and I just wanted it to end. I failed to realize that God wanted to accomplish something much bigger, and specifically in my own life, there was a deep work that he wanted to do. What was done to me wasn't right, but God was and still is using this to change my own character. The fifth thing, Joseph blessed his brothers. Blessing your accuser is a final act that you have completely forgiven them. In Joseph's case, the relationship was restored and he tangibly blessed them by bringing the whole family to Egypt to care and to provide for them. In many cases, because of the severity of the situation in your own life, there may be no relationship. Whatever this is, you could start praying for God to pour out a blessing on your accuser. And this is not going to come easy, as everything within you doesn't want them to be blessed. You don't want them to succeed. But rather, deep down, you want them to pay for what they've done. Leave the justice part to God. If you take justice in your own hands, your peace is just going to be stripped from you. Start by asking God to give you his heart for your accuser. It's not going to be easy. But as you ask, God will work deep in your heart. And your prayers for blessing will become easier and they're going to become a lot more sincere. Forgiveness is not a one-time event. It's a lifelong process. And God doesn't want you to succeed in any way by walking in forgiveness. The devil doesn't want you to succeed in any way by walking in forgiveness. He's going to play reels of the past. And if you allow yourself to walk down that road, you will quickly be lured back into the depths of your despair. Our God is the King, and the enemy has no authority over our lives. Don't give him an inch, but cry out to God that he will intervene and complete the work that he started in you. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus, my heart is that you would know him, because walking out forgiveness is incredibly difficult with having him in your life and a part of it. And forgiveness is really, it's not even possible without having Jesus a part of it. It's just really simple. You just say, Jesus, I'm sorry for my sin that I've committed against you. I want you to come and be a part of my life. I want you to reign and to take over in my life. I commit my life to you. Thank you, Jesus, for coming in and being a part of my life. It's that symbol. And that's an exciting day if you have said that this morning. And that's all I got to share this morning.